In Chapter 2, we introduced Operator as the repository of information regarding the observable it represents. We now discover what the operator does to the quantum state when it operates. We have been using ketsai to represent the quantum state. It must have unit length, as the total probability of measurement of any physical quantity must always be 1. Therefore, the inner product of the state with itself is 1. We now allow the state to evolve to some other state, ketsai prime, by mathematically applying some linear operator u. Length of the new ket must remain to be 1. Hence, we can conclude u dagger u equals to the identity operator. An operator u is said to be a unitary operator if it satisfies the equation above. A useful geometric view is that the unitary operator rotates the ket in Hilbert space. We now parameterize u with the real parameter theta. The parameter quantifies how much the state has changed. Taylor series expansion of the operator yields the equation on the screen, where u prime of 0 is the first derivative of u with respect to theta, evaluated at theta equals to 0. O of theta square denotes the terms that are second order and higher. We note that u changes the state by an amount according to the value of the parameter theta. When theta equals to 0, the state must remain unchanged, and we can conclude u of 0 is the identity. Substitute into the previous equation yields u of theta equals to I plus u prime theta plus O of theta square, taking the Hermitian adjoint of both sides, and noting that the identity operator is Hermitian and the parameter is real, yields the following equation. We now multiply the expansions of the unitary operator and its Hermitian adjoint, and equating the result to the identity, as u is unitary. We also make theta sufficiently small to delta theta, such that second and higher order terms are negligible. Then comparing the terms that a first order in delta theta yields, u prime dagger plus u prime times delta theta equals to 0. Provided that delta theta is not 0, we can conclude u prime equals to minus u prime dagger. If we set u prime to I tau, then tau is always Hermitian. Hence, for very small changes of the state, we can write the unitary operator as below. The minus sign is by convention. An appreciably large change is achieved by large amount of small changes. We will have used delta theta equals to theta over n and the definition of exponential function to get the final result. We have established that u of theta equals to e to the minus I theta tau, where tau is a Hermitian operator. Right multiply both sides by ket psi, then differentiating with respect to theta and rearrange yields the following equation. Since tau is Hermitian, it may represent an observable, and this is indeed true. We have discovered that the operator representing the observable is not only the repository of the spectrum and definite state of that physical quantity, but they also have another role as the generator of u and the transformation that u achieves. The Hermitian operator tau gives the rate of change with respect to the parameter theta. Turns out there's a deep connection between conservation laws and continuous symmetry, as stated in Noether's theorem, which says for every continuous symmetry, we can associate a conservation law. Newton's first law states that provided there's no external force, momentum is conserved under translation. Thus, we associate momentum conservation with translational symmetry and define momentum as the generator of translation. We'll justify this choice further in Chapter 5. The translation operator can therefore be written as T of A equals to e to the minus IAP over h bar, where a is the distance displaced and h-bar in the denominator ensures the exponent is dimensionless as exponentiation of a unit is undefined. It is physically plausible that the translation operator is an exponential operator in displacement, As for sequential translations, operators multiply, but displacements add, which is exactly the property of an exponential function. When the momentum operator acts on a state, it gives the rate of change at which the state changes as we translate the system in space. We shall now begin to derive a very fundamental result in quantum mechanics, the canonical commutation relation. We begin by making the following observation. After the system has been displaced by some small distance, delta A, the expectation value of the new distance is the original expectation value plus the small distance. Then after some algebraic manipulation, we obtain the equation on the screen. Equating the terms that are first order in delta A yields the equation on the screen. Cancelling delta A on both sides and using the definition of commutator yields I over h bar times the commutator of p and x equals to 1. Then multiply both sides by ih bar and use the negative sign to swap the order of arguments in the commutator yields the canonical commutation relation. We have seen at the end of the last chapter that the Heisenberg uncertainty principle is a direct consequence of this commutator. We can use the fact that operators operating in different degrees of freedom commute to generalize this result to three dimensions. It is left as an exercise for the audience to derive this commutation relation in three dimensions by considering translation in 3D space. It is often easier to work with wave functions in physical space rather than abstract state vectors in Hilbert space. The most useful representation is often the position representation. We shall now derive the form of the momentum operator in position representation as we have promised back in chapter 3. We begin by Taylor series expanding the wave function around x. We then substitute in a equals to y minus x to yield the equation on the screen. We then recognize the sum is the exponential function and write the wave function in bracket notation. Therefore, e to the power of this differential operator has the effect of shifting the wave function along by distance a. We can also generalize this equation to three dimensions. Where we have defined the del operator to be a vector operator in three dimensions. To proceed, we consider the effect of translation operator on a definite state of position. Taking the Hermitian adjoints of both sides and right multiply by ket psi yields the equation on the screen. We now equate to the result obtained previously to yield bra x e to the iap over h bar ket psi equals to e to the a partial by partial x bra x ket psi. Equate the terms that are first order in A in the Taylor series expansion of the exponential function yields the equation on the screen. We now cancel A on both sides and multiply by minus IH bar to obtain the final result. This is the form of the momentum operator in position representation. This equation can also be generalized to three dimensions. By analogy, provided there's no external torque, angular momentum is conserved under rotation. Thus, we associate angular momentum with rotational symmetry and define angular momentum as the generator of rotation. The rotation operator can thus be written as r of alpha equals to e to the minus alpha dot j over h bar, where alpha's direction is the axis of rotation and the length of the vector corresponds to angle of rotation. Note that the hat on top of alpha now means unit vector instead of operator. When the angular momentum operator acts on a state, it gives the rate of change at which the state changes as we rotate the system. For small rotation delta alpha and using 3D geometry, yields that the new vector is the original vector plus the cross product of the original position vector with the axis of rotation. Then after some further algebraic manipulation, we obtain the equation on the screen. then equating the terms that are first order in delta alpha and only considering a single component, xi, yields the expression on the screen. We now use the Levitch-Vieta epsilon to define a cross product between two vectors. We now use the summation notation to write the dot product and cross product, and using the rules for manipulating commutators to take the sum and the numbers out of the commutator. Cancel the sum over j and the delta alpha j on both sides and multiply by minus ih bar yields the commutator of jj and xi equals to minus ih bar sum over k epsilon ijk xk. Using the fact that the Levitch-Vieta epsilon is antisymmetric in the sense that minus epsilon ijk equals to epsilon jik and both I and j are dummy variables to obtain the important result of the commutator of ji and xj equals to ih bar sum over k epsilon ijk xk. The result can be generalized by replacing xi with any other vector operator, as we have only used the fact that operator is vector when deriving the commutation relation. For example, if we rotate the entire system, the momentum vector is also rotated. One of the most important commutation relation is obtained by replacing the position operator with angular momentum operator itself to obtain the commutator between ji and jj equals to ih bar sum over k epsilon ijk jk. This has far-reaching consequences. It is not possible to simultaneously and precisely specify the angular momentum in two orthogonal directions. Substitute the commutator into the uncertainty principle derived in chapter 3 yields the uncertainty principle for angular momentum. Therefore, the more angular momentum there is in one direction, the greater the minimum uncertainties in two orthogonal directions. To derive the commutation relation between angular momentum operator and the scalar operator, we start by observing that the expectation value of a scalar operator S is invariant under rotation. We now left multiply both sides by R and denoting it's unitary to obtain SR equals to RS. Hence, all scalar operators commute with rotation operator. As rotation operator is a function of angular momentum operator, we can conclude the commutator between any component of the angular momentum operator commutes with scalar operator. One of the most important scalar operator is the total angular momentum squared operator, which commutes with any components of the angular momentum operator. Hence, there exists a complete set of mutual eigenstates of both operators. It is possible to simultaneously and precisely specify both the total angular momentum and the angular momentum along only one axis by choice. We have found that momentum is the generator of translation, angular momentum is the generator of rotation, but the remaining question is what generates time evolution? In an isolated system, energy is always conserved. Furthermore, physics laws does not change from day to day. Thus, we associate energy conservation with time evolution symmetry. Energy is the generator of time evolution.